Welcome, everyone. I'm pleased to introduce this week's speaker, Rostislav Grigorchuk. Professor Grigorchuk completed his PhD in 1978 at Moscow Lomonosov State University and his habilitation in 1985 at the Steklov Institute of Mathematics. He has held various academic positions, ultimately joining the mathematics department at Texas A&M in 2002 and becoming a distinguished professor in 2008. Professor Grigorchuk has achieved many awards and accomplishments over his career. To name just a few, in 2012, he became a fellow of the American Mathematical Society. And in 2015, he was awarded the Leroy P. Steele Prize for seminal contributions to research for his influential paper, Degrees of Growth of Finitely Generated Groups and the Theory of Invariant Means, where he presented his remarkable discovery of a family of groups of intermediate growth, providing counterexamples to a conjecture of Milner. I could go on about Professor Grigorchuk's many accomplishments, but instead I should leave some time for him to give his talk. So I will now turn it over to Slava, who will talk to us about groups, growth, and spectra.
Thank you very much, Rossel. basically, this is the talk that I give on Monday in my department. And I was requested to speak clearly for graduate students and include in my talk not only recent results, but results from the past. And so I decided why not to repeat this, what is the reason to prepare the two different talks, colloquium talks for Texas A&M and for Ohio. With small modifications, I will repeat my talk. Also, it's now clear that basically I will be unable to speak about spectra because of absence of time. But tomorrow I will give a talk at the seminar of mathematical physics harmonic analysis in my department, where there will be a short survey on spectra, on graphs and groups. So if somebody is interested, he is welcome. It will be at 2 p.m. Of Texas time, so 3 p.m. of your time, I think. Let me begin with kind of panorama. And by the way, I completely forgot that in Ohio you have outstanding topologists, and so it's quite dangerous to use word topology in the abstract or whatever, but okay, what I can do, slides are prepared. So I will start with some kind of panorama of the world of groups. There are plenty of group theorists in your department or people from other areas of mathematics dealing with groups. And you know that a variety of groups is huge. There are finite groups, and you have great specialists in theory of finite groups, classification of finite groups, locally finite, compact, locally compact, Lie, Polish, topological groups. Another hierarchy is abelian, important, solvable, something that we teach usually even in undergraduate course in view of Galois theory and so on. Also, there are not always included in the undergraduate courses and classes of elementary amenable groups. I will give a definition later. there are modern directions of group theory, like geometric group theory, asymptotic group theory, and then such classes as groups with Kasdan property T play important role, Gromov-hyperbolic groups, Gulyan U, my colleague, axiom A groups, Ha group, groups with AT, which are called also AT minable. More recent classes, topological full groups, Sofield groups, and so on. So really it's enormous well. And by the way, let me advertise a journal which was created soon, Groups Geometry and Dynamics, which was created soon after my coming to Texas in 2006, I think. So we published excellent papers on the border between group theory, geometry, and dynamics. You are welcome to submit. Now to Eli. There are such classes shown here. Groups acting on rooted trees, so there is rich theory of groups acting on trees. But if you specify that some vertex is special and should be fixed point, then Basser theory like collapses and come to the world of group acting on rooted trees, the so-called so similar groups, automaton groups, branch groups, iterated monodromy groups. And all this I can like characterize as TAMU groups, Texas A&M groups, because we have a great specialist in this area, but we have a strong competitor, namely Rochelle. Rochelle compete with us and have very successful results in this part of group theory. And let me remind that there is wonderful book by my colleague, Volodymyr Nekrashevich, so similar groups. Now, you know, groups appear mostly as a group of symmetries of objects, groups of automorphism, of isometries, homeomorphism, diffeomorphisms. And among modern direction in group theory, we, additionally to classical combinatorial group theory, we have a geometric group theory, asymptotic group theory, measured group theory, and we study groups up to isomorphism, commensurability, quasi-isometry, measure equivalence, and other equivalence relations, which are much weaker than just isomorphism. Now I will describe some universe of finitely generated groups. So let G be is usually notation of a group. Usually it is G of gamma, I prefer G. A will be system of generator. I will consider finitely generated group. So I assume A is finite generating set. So what it means to be a generating set? It means just that every element of a group can be presented as a product of elements from A or A inverse. Or maybe can inverse, take inverses of generators. And the pair GA is called marked group. Here, order. Order is important. The repetition of the same element is allowed. Identity element may appear. This is not forbidden. In 1984, I introduced space, which here is denoted MM, space of M generated marked groups, which happen to be a totally disconnected, compact, metrizable space. I will give a hint. So elements of this space are marked groups with natural identification of them. And topology is kind of Kelly topology. Two marked groups are close in this topology if the Kelly graphs are isomorphic in the big neighborhood of the identity element. So we need just to refresh in memory what is Kelly graph, and let me remind you. So geometric group theory prefer to deal with groups given by graphs. By graphs, if we have marked group, we can associate with pair GA a graph with the set of vertices V, which is just the set of elements of a group, and this is the set of edges pairs. Of two elements, the difference between them is just multiplication by generator. So G, comma AG, such pair constitute the set of edges. This is left version, you can consider right version, and there are various modifications of the notion of Kelly graph. They are vertex transitive, means that a group of right translation act on left Kelly graph transitively by automorphism. Now the concept of Schreier graph or coset graph is more general. So additionally, you have a subgroup H in G Now you have triple group, subgroup, and generating set, and you associate a graph where the set of vertices is just the set of left cosets. And again, the set of edges are pairs of cosets different just by generator. So coset GH is connected to coset AGH, where A is arbitrary generator. And next slide show examples of Kelly graphs. In fact, when I showed you at the beginning, first page of the journal, here already was presented Kelly graph of some group acting on Poincaré disk by isometries. Here, for more examples, this is a Z square, two dimensional grid, shown slightly in an unusual way. This is Kelly graph of a free group, it's a regular tree. This is a Kelly graph of surface group of a fundamental group of oriented surface of genus 2. And this is a graph of group of intermediate groups, which will play important role in the future. In fact, all these examples will play important role. There will be no many examples involved. And now Schreier graphs. So here is bunch of Schreier graphs associated with the group of intermediate growth that was on previous slide, maybe not best possible picture. This is example Schreier graph associated with group that was invented by Zoran Sunich and me, Hanoi Tower game on the three packs. This is a Schreier graph of group called Basilica. Never mind, these graphs are regular graphs of even degree. And if there is no involution, if involutions among generators are involved, then just any degree may appear. And in fact, any regular graph of even degree can be realized as Schreier graph of even of a free group. So it's a really big family of graphs, Schreier graphs. But when graph is presented as a Schreier graph, then algebra is involved in certain way. And despite the fact that the graph may have trivial group of automorphism, still it's quite possible that this algebraic realization is useful. And we have many examples of this sort. And now I already use the word amenable group, and maybe I will use amenable graph, and you have plenty of specialists in your department which are very well familiar with this fundamental notion introduced by von Neumann in 1929. And there are something like 100 different definitions of this notion, but the most accessible perhaps is the definition. So a graph of uniformly bounded degree. Degree of vertex is number of edges accident to the vertex. if degrees of all vertices are uniformly bounded, this is the case that I consider. And in this case, we call a graph amenable if this value, so what we take finite subsets F in the set of vertices. We use any reasonable definition of boundary of such set and take ratio of the number of points in the boundary divided on a number of vertices in set and take infimum of all subsets. And sometimes this is called Cheeger constant or variation of Cheeger constant, but we assume that it is zero. So graph is amenable if this infimum is zero, and in group theory, this is called Fellner condition. And finitely generated group can be defined as a amenable, finitely generated group is amenable if its Kelly graph is amenable, and this definition doesn't depend on the choice of generators. And if group is not finitely generated, then it is amenable if and only if every finitely generated subgroup is amenable. Okay, and here we have example of Z square. So if you take square of size 2n plus 1, and the perimeter is linear, number of points inside is quadratic, so ratio goes to 0, so infimum is 0 in this case, it's example of amenable, while for free group of rank 2, we deal with four regular infinite, four regular 3, and in this case, the constant is positive, and interested student may try to evaluate to compute it. So this is an example of non-amenable group, and if a group contains non-amenable, then it is non-amenable. So all group containing free subgroup on two generators are non-amenable. Now I go back to the space of M-generated groups, and there is a natural embedding of M into M plus one space, and you can take union of this space, and this is what I call universe of finitely generated groups. And we may study typical properties of groups in this universe, or consider some probability measure, or even not probability measure on these spaces, and ask what are typical properties of groups with respect to this measure. So there are already studies of this sort. It's approach different from the approach suggested by Gromov, like random group. It's my approach. And, okay, so in 1984, I got the first kind of interesting result about this space. Namely, it was shown that for every m number of generators, at least two, you see, if number of generators is one, it's cyclic group, not so remarkable, but starting from two due to Bernard Neumann, it's 1937, when was shown that there are uncountably many two generated groups, so it's a rich class of groups. So I showed that the space of M generated groups contains a counter subset, which if to delete a countable subset, in fact, a dense countable subsets of points, consists of very exotic groups, namely of infinite torsion. Sometimes I will say torsion, sometimes I will say periodic groups. So it means every element has finite order, amenable, but not elementary amenable, and of intermediate growth. Then a branch, just infinite, and so on. So many other unusual properties. So in this space, there is a compact, counter-compact, consisting of exotic groups. And by the way, that time and now I repeat the question, can somebody compute counter-Bendix on rank of these spaces? So it has isolated points, so you can delete them, new isolated points will appear, you delete and so on. And on some countable ordinal, this will stop. So what is this ordinal? And the first general, one more general fact established by my advisor, Anatoly Stupin, expert in ergodic theory, by the way, who unfortunately in November passed away because of COVID in age 80. So he observes that amenable groups constitute a G delta subset of this space. And by the way, elementary amenable, now it is known as the, it's not Borel subset. And next slide is something interesting. The pleasure of a life of mathematician consists in what? In getting good results, solving good problems, developing new theories, dealing with good students. But one side of pleasure could come with well asked questions, good questions. By the way, there is a Guido Mislin book of problems book. It's on my shelf in 3 meters far from me. I time to time look at this book. I am happy to say that I formulated hundreds open questions, and not all of them are extremely good, but some of them were good. And here is the example. So in 2000, Yehuda Shalom, he proved that every finitely generated Kasdan group is a homomorphic image of a finitely presented Kasdan group. So what is Kasdan group? Kasdan group is a group that has a property that if a unitary represent any unitary representation of it all contains almost invariant vector, then in fact it contains invariant vector. So it means it contains one-dimensional sub-representation. And I don't know why I wrote this from Shalom article, why he has every finitely generated, because they are automatically finitely generated. It was proved by Kasdan when in 1967 he introduced this remarkable class of groups. But with Zhukov, we conjectured that there are Kasdan groups which are not finitely presented. It was shown by Vromov. And with Zhuk, we conjectured that every Kasdan group has finitely presented cover by Kasdan group. Finitely presented meaning involving finitely many relations, group given by finite presentation, by generators and relations. So, and Yehuda Shalom in his article writes, the result answers a question raised by Zhuk and me. Recall that contrary to Kasdan's conjecture, not every group with property T is finitely present. So Kasdan, who introduced Kasdan groups, made a wrong conjecture. Well, we made a correct conjecture. And one of consequences of this remarkable result of Yehuda is the following fact that a subset of Kasdan groups in space FM generated group is open. So this is published in this article. But not every finitely generated amenable group has a finitely presented cover. I don't know who was the first who observed this, but maybe Bierian-Strebel. The theory of sigma invariance or whatever. Classical example is Lamplighter group, which will appear soon and will play important role. And another example is a group of intermediate growths, which I will denote in this way and call it ABCD group because it's generated by elements ABCD involutions. So surprisingly, Kasdan group have. But here I forgot, not every finitely generated amenable group has finitely generated amenable, finitely presented amenable cover. Sorry, amenable is, of course, a free group covers, but it's not amenable. Yeah, so big difference between Kasdan groups and amenable. This covering property, and by the way, there is paper by Mustafa Ben Lee, Pierre Delarab, and me where like we prove this for this group of intermediate growths and for all family. And in fact, for some other classes of group acting on rooted trees. Okay. Excuse me. There are many ways to present a group. Group can be generated by matrices, I don't know, defined in many ways as Galois groups or whatever. But one of classical ways to present is by generators and relations. So G is presented in this way. A is a set of generators. R is the set of relators. Relators are words in the alphabet of generators and inverses. And if we equate a relator to one, we get relation. So sometimes we write here just words, sometimes we write that they are equal to one, relations. And here I will give you a few examples of groups. Like not very sophisticated. Starting with trivial group. So trivial group can be given by this presentation. Each relator, each generator is equal to one. Free group, M generators of rank M, empty set of relations. One relator group of this sort, so two M generators, product of commutators equal to one, commutator is a known thing. And this is just a fundamental group of a oriented surface of genus M. So here, genus two is shown, very well known, very important group. Now, when we have two groups, what interests us? First of all, we are interested if groups are isomorphic. For them to be isomorphic, there must be, so consider for instance, this pair, gamma M and FM. Who knows, maybe they are isomorphic. But no, they are not in our case. But to have isomorphism, first of all, we should have a homomorphism from one group onto another. We call this epimorphism. And there is no epimorphism from gamma M onto Fm plus one, onto free group of rank larger than M. It's not difficult to show, but not absolutely obvious. But there is epimorphism from gamma M onto FM. Namely, you send all generators BI to identity element. So you consider the normal subgroup generated by them. Then these generators disappear and relation disappear because commutation with one is one. And so you get empty set of relators. And around 1990, when studying quadratic equations in groups, trying to describe the set of solutions of the quadratic equation, and this my interest came from a reading of Alexander Rosborough thesis. I was opponent of his PhD thesis, and it was about equations in free group. So very nice, beautiful theory. But I asked Sasha, okay. Let us apply your theory to the equation when now let AI, BI be not generator, but unknowns, variables. So consider this as equation in a free group of certain rank. How to apply your theory? Okay, it was interesting conversation, but right now I want to mention that it started to be, and this is not difficult to show, and in principle, topologists like Heiner Zischen also knew about this, and we have even a joint publication with Heiner Zischen, Kochan, and me. We observe that for every M, essentially, there is only one epimorphism from gamma M from surface group onto free group. In what sense only one? When we have, so one epimorphism I described, we send all generators BI to identity. But we always can apply a fast automorphism of a group, and gamma M has a very rich group of automorphism, very important group, is related to mapping class group. And then follow this this fixed one. And the fact is that any epimorphism essentially can be obtained in this way. Hmm. By the way, if instead oriented surfaces, we consider non-oriented, then situation become more complicated. There is no uniqueness, but a number of epimorphism up to such equivalence is finite, still finite, and completely classified. Now, combining fact four, this last one, and Grigory Perelman's solution of Poincaré conjecture gives us the following fact. For every M, there is only one, again, modular automorphism of gamma M, epimorphism from gamma M onto direct product of two copies of a free group of rank M. So here we have two M generators, here we have two M generators. It's easy to see that there is epimorphism from gamma N to the direct product. here we were sending BI to one, but we can send AI to one and get kind of complementary epimorphism, and both of them will give epimorphism, and all epimorphism now arise in this way if we are allowed to apply automorphism of gamma M. So this fact requires a solution of Poincaré conjecture. And in fact, the last statement is equivalent to Poincaré conjecture. This was observed by John Stoney, great topologist and group theory guy. So problem is solved, but I don't know any, but we see that basically Poincaré conjecture is a problem not only of topology, every simply connected closed three-dimensional manifold is homomorphic to standard free, sphere, but it's also a problem of group theory. And I don't know any group theorists who would say, okay, I understand Perelman's proof. And honestly, I even don't know topologists, pure topologist. So it would be nice if somebody find kind of combinatorial proof of this fact, because so far Perelman proof is heavy analysis and so on. Okay, but now what we do? We replace gamma M by free group of rank 2M. And we ask, we consider now epimorphism from F2M to direct product. And this is conjecture again of Curinciano and me around 1990, suggested that there is only one epimorphism of this sort if to use automorphisms of a free group. So modular group of automorphism, we have still the only epimorphism. And right now, the bunch of my examples that I consider are trivial group, free groups, direct product of two copies of free groups, F is group. But already deep problems are involved. In particular, there are famous Hirschberg conjectures or questions about sister algebras associated with this direct product. So even simple groups arise a very difficult question. And if my Curciano and my conjecture is correct, then this would imply the famous Andrews Curtis conjecture, one of the most famous conjectures in topology. Namely, it states that if you have a balanced presentation, so M generators and M relators representing trivial group, then by the so-called elementary Nielsen transformation, it can be reduced to the presentation that I use at the beginning to show you a presentation of trivial group. So all generators are relators. And elementary Nielsen transformations are allowed to permute generators, to replace generator by inverse, or conjugate generator by arbitrary word in the alphabet of generators and the inverses. By the way, this conjecture, I was happy to learn recently that it is included in Tim Riley, professor in Cornell, in his talk with such title, Outstanding Problems in Low Dimensional Topology and Group Theory. You can go on his webpage and find file of this talk, maybe presented in several places. Now, some unexpected fact, corollary of theorem one. Theorem one was theorem about Cantor's set with special property in the space of marked groups. So one of corollaries is the fact that up to quasi-isometry, there are uncountably many Riemannian surfaces of constant negative curvature minus one, infinite genus, with one end and with co-compactly and freely acting group of isometries. So here is a first page of paperback version of Springer's publication of book with this title, with Office Collins, Kurchano, Cishan, and me. And it contains, on the front page, it contains my theorem. Surprisingly not popular at all, but here is a complete classification of non-compact Riemannian surfaces, non-compact oriented surfaces that allow co-compact, totally disconnected action of a group. Of homeomorphism. So Poincaré disk is missing here, or sphere with one hole, and the surface. So this is sphere with counter set of holes. This is infinite genus two ends, counter set of ends, and this is the case when genus is infinite and only one end. So the last theorem that I stated, it's a theorem about this surface. So there are uncountably many structures of surface of negative curvature minus one, allowing compactly acting group of isometries, and all of them are pairwise not quasi-isometric. So quasi-isometry is equivalence relation much weaker than isometry, and I will not give you a definition, just you are allowed to perturb metric, and it's a very weak equivalence relation. For instance, integer z are quasi isometric to the real life. This Gromov's usually attributed to Gromov definition. Okay. Now, two infinitely presented groups. So the Lamplighter that was mentioned. It can be defined as a risk product of group of order two and infinite cyclic group, or as a semi-direct product of this sort, or as a group given by two generators and this set of relations, so infinitely many relations. C is idempotent, and C commute with any conjugation of C by some power of A. So this is one group. It's a metabolian group. Metabolian group infinitely presented of exponential growth. And now ABCD group, group of intermediate growth. I will speak, it will be a culmination part of my talk, growth. It will come very soon to this, but okay, group is given by this presentation for the involutions ABCD, product BCD equal one, and then infinite to infinite series of relations. So we have relate to AD to the power four, this one, and we include these relators and also include all weights that will appear when apply powers of substitution sigma, replace A by ACA and so on. So each time you get longer and longer relation, and such way you get presentation. So group is not finitely presented. And in fact, this presentation is not minimal, none of relators can be deleted without changing of a group. By the way, there are finitely generated groups that don't have in minimal presentation. I asked this question, and Yves de Cornelier found the examples. Those was one example, and soon after it, I constructed uncountable family, which now I call it like ABCD omega group. So now I take any infinite ternary sequence the omega corresponds a group omega, again generated by four involutions, but definition of BCD is slightly different from, it depends on this oracle omega. So the previous group corresponds to periodic sequence 0, 1, 2. When we take periodic sequence 0, 1, infinity, it's usually called Anna Ersley group, who studied thoroughly this group in this wonderful article, very influential, where theory of random walks first boundary to growth was developed by Anna Erschler. And so this compact of groups that I started with is basically consists of these groups G omega, and they have several properties that were already mentioned. So they are infinite finitely generated torsion groups. Sometimes they are, this is called Bersite type groups. They have intermediate growth. They are branch, just infinite, and so on. And here, just very quickly, let me recall that Bersite problem is one of the most famous and difficult problems in algebra. It has three branches, general, bounded, and restricted, solved by these great mathematicians. And the known group theory specialist Yuri Mezhlyakov in 1982, he wrote that getting new examples of finitely generated infinite periodic groups is comparable with getting stones from the moon. So it was 82, almost 4 years ago. Do we have many stones from moon now? Since that time, not so much, but some of them came recently in this wonderful article of my colleague, Volodymyr Nekrashevich. We'll come back to this. So palindromic subshifts and simple periodic groups of intermediate growths. And the work on Nekrashevich is heavily based on Yaroslav Vorobets' theory of Schreier graphs associated with this group of intermediate growths. Time is running quickly, as usually. So this group acts on a binary rooted tree by automorphism. A just switches these two edges and no further action inside. B, CD, they fix array one infinity, this array. And B acts here as A, here as A, here trivially, and then periodically repeated. So this is a kind of a typical example of a group acting on a rooted tree and acting in some similar way, in the sense that, for instance, if we take action here, it's copies action of A on the whole tree. And if we consider action of B on this part, it's mimics action of C on the whole tree. So such groups we call self-similar, and I will not give a precise definition. It's not important for my talk, but a group is self-similar if it acts on some similar object in some similar way. And some similar object, a wonderful example is the regular rooted tree. Oh, another way to define is a group generated by states of invertible Mealy type automata, and where operation is a composition. And here is a figure which contains a bunch of Moore diagrams of automaton of a binary or ternary alphabet, which are generating remarkable groups. So this is group of intermediate growths, five states, A, B, C, D, generators. This state presents identity element. This generates Lamplighter group, basilica, iterated monodromic group of polynomial z square plus I. Basilica is iterated monodromic group of polynomial z square minus one. So all holomorphic dynamics, Julia sets, they begin with study of iterations of these polynomials. These two automata generate Hanoi tower tower groups on 3 packs, 4 packs. This is Bellaterra automaton. This automaton states are independent. States A, B, C, D of this automaton generate free group of rank 3. And it was open question for 25 years, asked by Said Sitki, if this is a fact that the group generated by automaton is free. And my colleagues, Yaroslav and Marie Vorobets, they showed that really the automaton generates a free group of rank 3. Okay, now culmination point growth. Let gamma be a graph and V0 connected in a locally finite, and we fix some vertex. And we consider function of a natural argument n, which counts number of vertices on the combinatorial distance from origin not greater than n. So kind of number of points in the ball of radius n around V0 in graph, where distance is combinatorial distance, the length of shortest path. Number of edges in the path is distance. A rate of growth of this function. So we are interested how it grows when n goes to infinity. We assume graph is infinite. And the rate of growth doesn't depend on initial vertex. But now, so there is plenty of types of growth of graphs. But now let gamma be a Kellogg. Then growth becomes much more restrictive and much more complicated for study. And it can be polynomial, like in case of grids, free abelian groups, or nilpotent groups. Can be exponential, like in case of free group, surface group, when m is greater or equal to most of solvable groups have exponential growth. And maybe intermediate between polynomial and exponential. Gromov in 1980 proved remarkable theorem that a group has polynomial growth if and only if it is wedging nilpotent. So only one direction was difficult, that polynomial growth implies that the group contains a nilpotent subgroup of finite index. So when we say wedgily something, it means a subgroup finite index with corresponding property, wedgily nilpotent, wedgily soluble, and so on. Photo. Okay, so maybe you are already tired. So two pictures. Can you recognize these people?
Yes, I see Milner.
Gromov and Milner. Gromov met in Zurich, ICM, 1994, wonderfully organized. Guido, were you involved?
What?
Were you involved in the organization process of conference in Zurich in 1994?
Yeah, I see the on the left is the ETH Zurich, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's right.
Tatiana, my collaborator, Tatiana Nanibida was involved. This is Milner in Moscow. He was invited by government of Moscow to celebrate 850th birthday. Moscow, yeah. And I was asked to be his guide.
Yeah. Okay, great, yeah.
Okay, so question, Milner asked a question in 1967. Is it correct that growth of finitely generated group is either polynomial or exponential? And in 84, I answered no. There are many, many groups of intermediate growth. Most of these G omega have intermediate growth. There are uncountably many types of growth. There are groups with incomparable growth. And at that time, I asked the following question. Does there exist a finitely generated simple group of intermediate growth? And this question was answered recently by Nekrashevich in those articles that already was mentioned, that there are many such groups. So palindromic subshifts, by the way, subshifts generated by substitution that was involved in present of my group of intermediate growth, all this play a role in Nekrashevich contraction. Surprisingly still, we don't know if does there exist a finitely presented group of intermediate growths. Okay, Rochelle, can I speak, say, 5-7 more minutes?
Yes, you're good. You can keep going, yes.
Okay. This slide show a motivation for growth. And it was Albert Schwarz who in 1957 first observed that the following, like, okay, so let n be a non-compact remaining manifold. Like in the case of graph, you fix a point and you could see the function of r. R is a radius, which is volume of a geodesic ball of radius r around x. So it's growth function of your manifold, and you are interested how it grows when r goes in infinity. And he proves that If N is a compact Riemannian manifold and NT that is a universal cover, then growth of universal cover is equivalent, the same as the growth of the fundamental group of the manifold. And these are examples like a Euclidean space and a hyperbolic space. I will skip this, and you can generalize this to Galois, not from universal covering to Galois covering. Namely, if you take normal subgroup of the fundamental group and consider regular covering corresponding of a compact manifold N corresponding to this normal subgroup, then growth of this regular cover is the same as growth of the factor quotient group, fundamental group by H. And this is how these continuum examples of surfaces was constructed using the fact that there are uncountably many types of growth. Okay, in the last 5 minutes, and this will be the end, I will tell very interesting story and conclude with the so-called gap conjecture. So a story about this group of intermediate growths that was created in 1980 as a group, a periodic group, as a group of Bersite type. In 84, I observed that it has intermediate growth, and that time I showed that growth is not less than growth of a partition function, exponent square root of n, but slower than the growth of this function with alpha, this number close to one, but less than one. After that, people made a lot of efforts to find precise asymptotic, and first Bartholdi and independent Mochik and Park, they showed that upper bound can be improved to this value where beta is this number. So a root of cubic polynomial is involved. So please remember this beta. On the left, Bartholdi and independently Leonov, they managed to add just 4 hundredths, slightly lower bound. But Anna Erschler and Tiani Zheng, they showed that basically upper bound is almost the same as so for every epsilon, growth of this particular group is bounded by from above and from below by this function. So basically, it's almost like exponent n to the power beta, but not still precisely slightly weaker result, still remarkable result published in Misiones. And still question remained if growth is exactly as growth of this function. So this is published in this article. And now there are two papers by Bartholdi, Erschler, and Kasabo and Park, published in Invenciones in Annals, which tells the following, just a summary of the result. We consider interval beta this fixed number, 0.76 and so on, till one, and for every data, there is a finitely generated group with growth, exactly growth of this function. And moreover, for any sufficiently regular function that between this and exponential function, there is group whose growth is equivalent to growth of this function. So we have the following picture of rates of growth of finitely generated group. We have countable series of polynomial degrees. We have this area where everything basically is packed. So here we have exponential growth of function exponent n to the power beta, which we don't know if it is achieved yet completely, but basically everything here is densely packed. And in 19, a long time ago, I made a conjecture that there is a gap. If growth is less than growth of partition function, then in fact, it is polynomial. And this is a gap conjecture. But surprisingly, all these results, they use my group of intermediate growth. This is why it is not possible yet to get any example of a group whose growth will be less than growth of my group. And maybe in fact, this gap area is even larger. Maybe it begins from here. So there is number of variations of this gap conjecture. I managed to prove it in 1989 for residually nilpotent groups, of groups approximated by nilpotent groups. For every non-identity element, there must be homomorphism into nilpotent group, such that image of element is not identity. And a few years ago, I proved that if the gap conjecture holds for the class of residually finite groups and for class of simple groups, then it calls for the class of all finitely generated groups. So unfortunately, if there would no examples of simple groups of intermediate growth, the life will be would be easier, but Nekrasheev showed that they exist. How residually nilpotent replaced by residually finite at the moment not clear. And I was going to tell in 2 minutes amenability in 2 minutes, but just let me mention that amenability was already pronounced. There was question if every amenable group is elementary amenable. No, all groups of intermediate growths are amenable, but not elementary amenable. People in your department use heavily, for instance, Vitaly and this property. But I think it's enough. Thank you for attention. And I am ready to answer all questions if they exist. Thank you.
Thank you, Slava. Yes, are there any questions?
So there is such a radio silence. Let me ask a question. So Slava, can you say a little bit more about this paper of Nekrashevich? Maybe a few little interesting things that are there, because you mentioned it more than once and it really seems to be very, very interesting. So can you say a few more words?
Okay. You see, when you have this contour, minimal contour system, and this is a contour set and minimal homeomorphism of it, you can introduce, consider define a so-called topological full group. It's a group of homeomorphisms for each element of this group, there is a partition on Clopin subsets, close and open, like Clopin subset, such that on each piece, element of a group act by some power of this homeomorphism. It's a contour group, but basically in all its commutator is finitely generated. And this is called topological full group. And for instance, you can start with any primitive substitution like 2MR substitution show here and consider subshift generated by this substitution. Omega tau, or for instance, substitution sigma that was in presentation of my group, it also leads to a minimal contour system. And then you get topological full group. And in 2010, with Kostya Medinets, we made these groups were introduced by Giordano, Putnam, and Scow, and their complete algebraic invariants of minimal contour systems up to flip conjugacy. Then Mathieu, Japanese mathematician, he developed a theory, proved several important properties, in particular that commutator is simple. So here simple groups appear, commutator is simple. And with Medinets, we conjectured one more good conjecture that every such group is amenable. For every minimal contour system, the topological full group is amenable, and so commutator subgroup is amenable, and commutator subgroup is finitely generated and simple. And by the way, these were the first examples of finitely generated infinite amenable simple groups created in this way. And this conjecture was confirmed by Katerina Yushchenko and Nicolas Monod, published in this article, and later Yushchenko, Nekrashevich, and Dreyasal, they kind of provided a condition of amenability, which is applicable basically to all existing amenable groups. And so Nekrasevich, he developed kind of this technique of topological full groups, but at the same time of Schreier graphs. And he came with the idea of fragmentation. So I have no, and also, yeah. So there is several publications by Daniel Lenz, Tatiana Nanibeda, and me, where we use presentation, this substitution sigma, which was on one of my slides, I don't know. A goes to ACA, so it's substitution on the set of four letters. And it gives minimal counter system, and the group of intermediate, my group of intermediate groups embed there. And Schreier graphs, I can show you Schreier graphs. So this how looks a Schreier graph, infinite Schreier graph to indie. So there looks like very, very simply, like the two periodic graph with loops. Group ZX has fundamental domain consisting of two points, but if we forget labeling. This Schreier graph, they come, okay, group X on a root, binary rooted tree, and so it acts on the boundary of the tree. On the boundary of the tree is a counter set. You take any point, you consider orbit, and then you build a graph of action on this orbit. And this is a Schreier graph. Now it just have labels A, B, C, D. And for different points, you get a different labeling. And in fact, all this is what is called a periodic order now. So with Lenz and Tatiana, we showed that this allows to compute, to show that in typical case spectrum of Markov or discrete Laplace operator on these Schreier graphs is a Lebesgue set of zero, counter set of Lebesgue measure zero. And this was done by reduction to random Schrodinger operator. But Volodya Nekrasevich used another kind of direction developed by Yaroslav Vorobets, this was mentioned. And there is no time to explain, but Vorobets like added to this picture three more graphs which have mirror symmetry. And they are palindromes. They are represented by infinite wets, two-sided infinite wets, which are palindromes. These palindromes play important role in construction of Nekrasevich and this idea of fragmentation. So sorry, in 2 minutes, I cannot say more, but I already stopped in the right, very good place because Nekrasevich is finishing a book with title Groups and Topological Dynamics. I'm a field publisher. And all this his theory will be described. So I think it will be very influential book. And the remaining four slides were about spectra and spectra. And as I told, tomorrow I will speak on our seminar. So people interested in spectral theory of graphs and groups are welcome to attend the talk.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Any more questions for the speaker?
Hello. You mentioned several times about fragmentation. It's probably has, there is a fragmentation lemma, which is used to prove, say, that groups of diffeomorphisms are simple. It's probably a completely different thing, right? So fragmentation lemma there says that if you have a diffeomorphism, you can write it as a finite composition of diffeomorphisms, each of which is simple in the sense that it is supported on a disk. So it is identity outside of a disk. So that's a fragmentation lemma that people like, for example, Banyaga, they use all the time to study diffeomorphisms groups. So that's different fragmentation, I guess, right?
Yeah, I think it's different. And the spirit could be similar, but technically it's different.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe you should invite Nekrasevich to give a talk.
Yes, we should.
I recommend.
All right, let's thank this. Oh yeah, go ahead. No, yeah. Okay, thank you. Let's thank the speaker. Thank you. Yeah, thanks for a wonderful talk, Slava.